The worlds of the ancient Greeks, Romans, Egyptians, Celts, and other once great civilizations are fascinating to modern minds, partly because all they accomplished without our technology. How did they do it? Here are some of the answers. Stonehenge, the prehistoric ring of standing stones on England's Salisbury Plain, is one of the great mysteries of the ancient world, in part because the questions surrounding it hit all the classic 5 W's and an H line of questioning. Who built it? What does it mean? Where did these rocks come from? When was it built? Why did they do it in the first place? How did they get these giant rocks over there anyway? It's like a 3-year-old designed Stonehenge as an excuse to let loose. Fortunately, for the sake of your itchy brain, researchers have made strides in answering at least one of those questions. According to scientists who know these sorts of things, evidence suggests that at least some of the stones used to construct Stonehenge came from quarries in Wales, some 180 miles away. Apparently, in these quarries, slabs of stone are already mostly vertically oriented, and so dragging these ready-made blocks out of the Welsh quarries for almost 200 miles was easier than carving stones out of a more local source. And it would have been even easier if they had just made it 18 inches tall instead. The Romans used concrete extensively in their architecture during the classical era of the Roman Republic, all the way until the fall of the Western Empire. Its versatility and quick hardening led to what is known as the Roman Architectural Revolution, and the freedom from the shortcomings of rock and brick gave the Romans the ability to implement the arches, vaults, and domes that ancient Roman buildings are known for. Its relative strength is also the reason that so many classic Roman structures — the Pantheon, the Colosseum, the Baths of Caracalla, the Pont de Garde, and numerous bridges and aqueducts — have survived to present day.
Without concrete, Rome and all modern cities would look very different today.
Following the collapse of the Western Empire, though, the technology of making concrete was lost until the mid-18th century, and modern concrete is a different composition. So for nearly 2,000 years, it was a mystery how the Romans made the material that built an empire. In 2015, though, a geophysicist at Stanford University named Tiziano Vinorio reportedly cracked the secret thanks to a catastrophe from her own youth, namely the eruption of the volcano Campi Flegre that forced the evacuation of the Italian city Pozzuoli in 1982. While studying the volcano, Vinorio discovered a concrete-like material that was practically identical to Roman concrete. The Romans, keen observers of the natural world, apparently took inspiration from nature's own concrete to formulate a material that literally changed history. Runes. The word itself sounds esoteric and magical, but runes were actually just letters in the alphabet used by different Germanic cultures to write their languages before they adopted the Latin alphabet. Some runic inscriptions, however, are harder to interpret than others. It turns out that this is intentional. A number of the inscriptions are written in code, and one of these centuries-old Viking codes, known as Jotunvalr, wasn't cracked until 2014. According to The Guardian, University of Oslo runologist K. Jonas Norby was able to figure out the secret thanks to the discovery of a stick on which two people had written their names in both Jotunvalr and standard runes. This allowed Norby to realize the trick was that the standard runes would be replaced by the last letter in the name of the rune. For example, the rune Mothor, which normally makes an M sound, would be replaced with the rune for R, because Mothor ends in R. Such rune sticks would have been used to communicate, but the use of codes, it seems, was less for privacy and more for the sake of a game that was meant to help teach runes. Or maybe even just to show off. Oh, that was wacky Vikings. On August 14, 1480, Ottoman Admiral Gedik Ahmed Pasha conquered the Italian city of Otranto following a 15-day siege. Thousands of men were killed, and women and children were sold into slavery. According to tradition, the remaining 800-plus able-bodied men of Otranto were given the chance to convert to Islam. They all refused and were executed. Known as the Martyrs of Otranto, those nameless men were canonized in 2013 as the patron saints of Otranto by Pope Francis. For hundreds of years, the skulls of those men have been displayed in large glass cabinets in the Cathedral of Otranto, all with their faces pointed toward the visitors. All that is, except for the so-called honeycombed skull, which is arranged to display the pattern of 16 perfectly round holes in its cranium. For centuries, there was mystery surrounding how and why the skull was perforated. According to Gizmodo, though, researchers at the University of Pisa seem to have cracked it in 2015. The perfectly rounded conical holes told researchers that the culprit would have used a half-moon-shaped tree pan, which, as everyone knows, is a drill bit used specifically for drilling into the skull. But the how is perhaps not as interesting as the why. The driller was likely harvesting that good, good bone powder, and it probably happened centuries after the martyr was killed. Why? In the late Middle Ages, powder made from the bones of saints or martyrs was believed to be particularly potent against paralysis, stroke, epilepsy, and other brain disorders. The Nazca people were an ancient civilization in what is now Peru, perhaps best known today for the mysterious Nazca lines, intricate and complex miles-long line drawings of subjects such as a hummingbird, a jaguar, trees, flowers, and a monkey. The Nazca people made these geoglyphs sometime between 500 BC and 500 AD, and were in many other ways a sophisticated and advanced society as well, including developing an intricate system for irrigating their crops. However, despite all the complexity and sophistication of the Nazca society, this entire civilization completely vanished about 1,500 years ago, and no one could explain why. Until 2009, that is. According to the BBC, researchers discovered that they disappeared due to deforestation. Basically, the Nazca cut down too many Warango trees to plant maize, not knowing that Warango trees were basically the only thing holding the ecosystem together. Without the trees in place, the area basically became a desert, and the Nazca were swept away by El Niño-related floods. It almost seems like there might be a lesson for a modern society to take away from the destruction of a once-flourishing society through their own hubris and destruction of the environment, but nah, probably not. In 1901, divers off the coast of the Greek island of Antikythera were exploring a Roman-era shipwreck when they discovered, among other treasures, the remains of a smallish wooden box. Inside that box was a complex array of gears that stumped scholars. In the 1970s and 1990s, advances in X-ray technology allowed researchers to determine that the device was likely designed to replicate the motion of the heavenly bodies — sun, moon, and planets. Beyond this, however, the secrets of the green-encrusted bronze cogs were too hard to unlock and failed to spark the imaginations of anyone besides ancient alien types. That is, until about 2006. According to Smithsonian, modern technology such as CT scans revealed more of the inner workings of the Antikythera mechanism, including previously hidden inscriptions showing that the object was basically an ancient analog computer. Yep, the device's complex series of over 30 interlocking bronze gears allowed the ancient Greeks to follow the movements of the sun and moon through the zodiac, predict eclipses, and model the irregular orbits of the moon. It even served as a calendar. Basically, it was the ancient equivalent of a smartphone, except you couldn't watch this video on it. Thank goodness for progress. According to the Greek historian Herodotus, sometime around 525 BC, the Persian ruler Cambyses II sent an army of 50,000 soldiers to attack the Egyptian oasis of Siwa. But a massive sandstorm appeared and completely buried the entire army, which was never seen again. Many historians dismissed it as a myth, but in 2009, a team of archaeologists discovered numerous artifacts near the oasis of Siwa that appeared to be Persian in origin, along with a mass grave filled with human bones. So much for myth. Rapa Nui, better known to English speakers as Easter Island, is home to numerous stone works, including platforms called Ahu, walls, houses, and petroglyphs. But it's most famous worldwide for its mysterious, enormous monolith statues called Moai, perhaps better known as the Easter Island Heads. These figures, many of which actually include bodies that have been buried over time by shifting soil, have perplexed archaeologists for decades. But answers have been hard to come by, as the native population was almost completely wiped out in the 19th century. One big question seems to have been answered, however. Researchers at Binghamton University in New York discovered that the location of the statues was, quote, "tightly linked with access to freshwater sources. The more water, the more statues. No water, no statues." The pattern proved to be consistent, so it seems for now at least one of the mysteries of Easter Island has been partially resolved. It's got something to do with water. Why and how the statues were built, though, remains a head-scratcher. The ancient city of Palmyra, now part of Syria, was once one of the wealthiest and most important cities of the Roman Empire. Its great wealth meant it was able to fill the city with monumental public works, such as its great colonnade, the Temple of Bel, and numerous tower-shaped tombs. All of this is well and good, but it raises questions for modern observers. Namely, why would you put such an important city in the middle of a desert? How did the people, you know, eat and drink? Well, the answer, it turns out, is pretty simple. Way back during the time of the Roman Empire, Palmyra wasn't a desert. It was actually more of an arid steppe. Grass roots would have kept rainwater from being absorbed by the ground, pooled into small creeks and rivers. It was enough to water crops for food and provide drinking water. The pyramids of Giza are the only remaining structures among the seven wonders of the ancient world, and they've remained a constant object of fascination for the over 4,500 years of their existence. And a source of puzzlement. Just how did the ancient Egyptians make them? How did they even manage to get those giant blocks of stone out of the quarries in the first place? Well, now we think we know. According to Lonely Planet, in 2018, archaeologists working in the quarries at the Hatnub site near the city of Minya uncovered a system of ramps that would have made it possible for ancient workers to raise up the enormous limestone blocks used to construct the pyramids. The structure contained a large central ramp with carved staircases running along each side that would have made it possible for multiple people to drag the blocks up and out. The ramp system on its own would not be enough to show that this structure was used in the development of the pyramids. But helpfully, some of the inscriptions were also uncovered dating this system to the time of the pharaoh Khufu, who built the pyramids, which is a pretty good sign in favor of these being pyramid ramps and not just used for sick nasty skate tricks. Check out one of our newest videos right here. Plus, even more grunge videos about your favorite stuff are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.